Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship. The clasp on my watch broke and I have not had it on and I feel like so out of place, so I'm glad I got up here on time. Good to see everybody this morning and good always as always to welcome those who are joining us on the live stream, worshiping with us. You are just as much of the worshiping community as those who are here today. Thank you to the Murray family, I think, who are providing flowers in honor of Reese's 18th birthday. So for those of us who remember him as like a little fireman at school at BBS, that's making me feel old. But congratulations to Reese on this milestone. Congregational meeting happens today after worship, so go out, grab a cup of coffee and whatever. After worship, there'll be some materials out there so that you can get an agenda and some of the budgeting information. And we will meet and have a presentation from the council and the business manager on that information. Christmas poinsettias, believe it or not, already time to start ordering them. So there are order forms at the little desk when you enter, and they will be, there's a box that you can put the money in. So please go ahead and get in your orders before December, or by December 3rd. Take note of some of the things on the calendar coming up, and this Wednesday especially, we'll be having Thanksgiving Eve worship service that's in partnership with Holy Redeemer Lutheran, and we'll be having worship here at 7, and then some fellowship to follow. So if you're in town, you're welcome to please come and join us. The back of the announcement page has lots of Advent information. So I encourage you to please take a look at that. It will be Advent midweek worship starts, believe it or not this Wednesday because that's Thanksgiving Eve, but the following Wednesday. So it's already right upon us. Information about the Advent dinner and sing-along of a special guest playing guitar to help us sing and celebrate. Christmas program. There are clipboards on the Get Connected board that you can sign up to be a reader or a singer or provide other parts of participating in that worship service on the 17th. And then some information about daily devotionals and a special Bible study on Thursday mornings or Advent. So please take a moment. Take that announcement sheet home with you so that you have that information handy. Point out to you one other item. You might remember a couple weeks ago we had the big butterfly wings hanging up as a reminder of our theme for next year's ministry of imagining a world transformed and set free. And so many of you got your picture taken next to the butterfly wings. So we have put together a poster, and they're displayed throughout the church. So take a moment to check that out. It's really cool to see everybody there with their transformed with their butterfly wings, and it's fun to be able to share that with you. Thank you again for being part of the dreaming and the imagining what God can do in the world through our congregation in the year ahead. I invite you then to please stand as you are able to begin our worship with confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God in whose image we are made, who claims us and calls us beloved. Holy One, Holy One, we confess that we are not awake for you. We are not faithful in using your gifts. We forget the use of our solutions. Jesus, our beloved, opens the door to us. Through Jesus, you are forgiven. By Jesus, you are welcome. In Jesus, you are called to rejoice. Let us live in the promises prepared for us from the foundation of the world. Amen. Call it Thanksgiving, right? Thanksgiving. So what does that make you think of? What does that make you think of?
I don't know.
You don't know? Okay. Well, let's see. Thanksgiving would mean giving thanks, right? So Thanksgiving would mean that we're living our thanks. And so that's just not one day of the year for us. That's all the time. We give our thanks to God every day in all sorts of ways, and then we live our thanks, by going out and sharing all that goodness with others. So every time that you are kind, were you kind this week? I bet you were, yeah. You think of the way you were kind. And every time you were friendly, yeah, friendly. Any time that you were helpful, were you helpful? Yeah, that one might be a little harder to come up with, no? Okay. We'll ask mom and dad later. So being helpful, being kind, being friendly, being loving, noticing when someone's in need. And when we notice that in our heart, we feel it in our heart. That's called compassion. Compassion. So anytime you had compassion this week, you were living in thanks. Living in thanks and sharing all the good gifts that God gives to us that we're thankful for, you are sharing them with the world. And so hanging up on the Get Connected Wall is a wreath that we made on Wednesday night. And it's got a wreath made out of clothespins, but we colored them in all kinds of fall colors. And then people wrote all the things that they were thankful for on the clothespins. So I think I might have a few extra. And so if you'd like to fill one out after church, let me know and we'll add your thanks to the wreath. Okay? All right. So let's see. Can you think of one way you might be living in thanks sometime today? Is there an opportunity where you could live in thanks today? Are you gonna help mom or dad with anything? Maybe. Maybe, okay. And you'll give thanks, right? We'll say thank you at supper, right? And we're gonna be giving thanks a lot today in church. We always give thanks a lot here in our service. So, and one of the things I'm giving thanks for is seeing all of you up here for church. And all of you who are out there watching us for the children's sermon out at home. So, all right, shall we say a prayer? You pray with me? Dear Jesus, thank you for all of your good gifts, all the ways that you have shown us your love and your compassion and your kindness and your care. And thank you that we can go out and live our thanks for you in the world, sharing that love and care and compassion and kindness with our neighbors and the rest of the community. All the world. So bless our families this week as we gather. Bless those who may not have a family to gather with, that they might find some fellowship and companionship. And for those who would be hungry, that they would also have an opportunity to feast. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thanks. Thanks.
The first lesson is from the first chapter of Zephaniah, the day of the Lord, Zephaniah 1, 7, and 12 through 18. Be silent before the Lord God, for the day of the Lord is at hand. The Lord has prepared a sacrifice. He has consecrated his guests. At that time I will search Jerusalem with lamps, and I will punish the people who rest complacently on their dregs. Those who say in their hearts, the Lord will not do good, nor will he do harm. Their wealth shall be plundered, and their houses laid waste. Though they build houses, they shall not inhabit them. Though they plant vineyards, they shall not drink wine from them. The great day of the Lord is near, near and hastening fast. The sound of the day of the Lord is bitter, and the warrior cries aloud there. That day will be a day of wrath, a day of distress and anguish, a day of ruin and devastation, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness, a day of trumpet blasts and battle cry against the fortified cities and against the lofty battlements. I will bring such distress upon people that they shall walk like the blind, because they have sinned against the Lord. Their blood shall be poured out like dust and their flesh like dung. Neither their silver nor their gold will be able to save them on the day of the Lord's wrath. In the fire of his passion, the whole earth shall be consumed. For a full and terrible end he will make of all the inhabitants of the earth. This is the word of the Lord. The second lesson is from the fifth chapter of 1 Thessalonians. Be alert for the day of the Lord. 1 Thessalonians 5:1-11. Now concerning the times and the seasons, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written to you, for you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night, when they say, there is peace and security. Then sudden destruction will come upon them as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and there will be no escape. But you, beloved, are not in darkness, for that day to surprise you like a thief. For you are all children of light and children of the day. We are not of the night and of the darkness. So then let us not fall asleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober and put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, this hope of salvation. For God has destined us not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing. This is the word of the Lord.
According to Matthew, the 25th chapter. For it is as if a man going on a journey summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. And then he went away. Now the one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had the 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. And then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward bringing 5 more, saying, Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have made 5 more. His master said to him, Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. And the one with 2 talents also came forward, saying, Master, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. And then the one who had received the 1 talent also came forward, saying,
Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went and I hid your talent in the ground. Here, have what is yours. His master replied, you wicked and lazy slave, you knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I did not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one with 10 talents. For to all those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. This is the gospel of the Lord. Be seated. I really can't wait to get out of Matthew. The weeping and the gnashing of teeth, the outer darkness. There's a message in there somewhere, but I'm a little worn out from trying to find it. So I took a look at Thessalonians today. And this is not to run or hide from the other passage, because actually I think looking at that one in Thessalonians gave me more insight into the gospel. So how many of you out there, when you were little, or those who have little ones, have had a nightlight in your home? Anybody had a nightlight? Yeah? Mm-hmm. We actually have one in our bathroom because, you don't have to wake up all the way, right, when you go into the bathroom. Just enough light to see in the middle of the night. So I had a nightlight when I was little. I remember it. It was, if I still had it, it'd be very, retro and vintage by now. But it wore a little nightcap. And its little head glowed and had on little pajamas and, probably should have really creeped me out, but it was comforting and had a soft glow. And it helped me see around the room. It helped me to see that there really wasn't anything lurking in the shadows, like my fear or like my imagination might want to tell me is there. It helped me to face what was really going on in the dark, just that little bit of light. So Paul is using a comparison of the light of the day and the darkness of the night. And I think because when he does this, he also uses examples of being drunk and being sober, that we can tend to decide that there must be a moral value on those things, that day is good, night is bad, right? But really, what I hear Paul saying is that there's a difference. There's a difference between living in the dark or in fear, and a difference between living in hope, having some light to see by. See, the times and the seasons for what they are. Paul says to them in the opening verse of this passage that you see what's going on out there. You know, I don't have to tell you. And that's true. We all turn on the news. We all read the paper. We all read our online news source, wherever we might get that. And we know what is going on out in the world. But at night, when Paul talks about people sleeping, right, would we be hiding in our sleep? And when Paul talks about getting drunk at night, right? There's any number of different intoxications we can take part in that distract us, that numb us, that help us to escape from the reality of things that go on in the world. So Paul's saying, don't kid yourselves. See the world as it really is. And then live in these times. Live in these times with a little bit of light, with some clarity. Live with integrity and authenticity and transparency. Not keeping things hidden or out of sight, but out in the open to be seen, to be lived through, not hiding or escaping. Now, that doesn't mean it's not good to unplug, right? It's good for all of us to get away from the screens, to get away from the noise of everything that's happening, especially because there's so much conflicting information, right? And in order to be able to see clearly, in order to be able to have a clear understanding of what's going on in the world, it's hard work, right? It's hard work to hunt out sources that we can trust are telling us what is really going on out there. So it's good to unplug. It's good to take a break from the noise, from the voices that maybe aren't as transparent or don't have as much integrity as we would wish in being able to go out and live in the world. But, and then it also gives us an opportunity, right, to restore our strength, to gather up our courage, to go back out again, to deepen ourselves in our faith and in our hope and in love, so that we are ready to go back out, seeing with eyes that are open, seeing beyond the shadows with some light. Now, we know it's always so much easier to just play along, right? It's easier to not speak out. It's easier to not ask those hard questions. It's easier to not work for change, to stick with the status quo, to say it is just the way it is. There's a difference, though, between seeing the world and things as they are and saying this is just the way it is. See, seeing the world and the way things are, we have a choice to accept it, to say, well, this is just the way things are, or to see how they are and to hope for the possibility of transformation and change. And so that's the direction I think Paul is leading us in, leading us to see the world as it is, but not being satisfied that it is what it is, but hoping, working for transformation wherever we can see that it's needed most. For those of you who have grown up with a Lutheran background, you may have over time heard a pastor, myself, or previous pastors talk about the theology of the cross. Luther talked about the theology of the cross versus the theology of glory. So the theology of glory is just like, oh, God is in God's heaven, all is right in the world, and everything's going to be great because we have God. Which isn't necessarily entirely untrue, but there's nuances to that, right? And so the theology of the cross is, there's a lot of hard stuff going on out there. Everything isn't always going to be all right in every situation, but we do have the gift of God, God's grace, God's mercy, God's forgiveness, God's love, God's hope, all the things that make it possible for us to see the world as it is and continue to live in it and work for change. Now, this image of armor, I have to point this out too, because just like thinking there's a moral judgment on night and day and good and bad and sober and drunk and all that, there is also the idea that this image of armor could be misunderstood as looking to go out and pick a fight. But I see this armor, and I think this is what Paul meant, is that it's about being equipped. Being equipped. Because if it's the breastplate of faith and love, well, those aren't weapons for going out and picking a fight, for starting trouble in that sense. Well, they are weapons for a fight, but they are for the safety of the person wearing them, right? So that faith and love, the breastplate, the helmet of hope, that is the protection that we have, so that we don't go out into this potential of things that aren't necessarily great, things that are hard, things that that cause suffering, that cause pain, either to us or to others, but that we can walk out with that armor on and not run from it, not run from that world that we see clearly in front of us, that the light shows us what's happening, but that we can face it with courage because we're equipped. We're equipped. Not ready for, you know, going out and starting a fight, but ready to go into the fray and feel protected, feel courage to be able to trust that God has more that is intended for the world. So a breastplate of faith and love is not a breastplate of fear and hate. And a helmet of hope is not a helmet of despair. Paul finally closes with encouraging the folks in Thessalonica to build one another up. Build one another up. Encourage one another as you have been doing. Strengthen one another to go out, to see, to do the hard work of seeing clearly, to do the hard work of keeping our own story authentic and with integrity, with transparency. Building one another up. That we can not face this task alone, but with the equipment that God gives us, and then with one another as a whole community. So my theory then is that this nightlight isn't really about fear, but it's about being brave, about having courage, about being able to trust in the Lord, because we can see what's out there and we can be equipped for it and not stay in the dark, wondering in fear what might be ahead or what might be going on, or hiding from what is there so that we don't see it, that we aren't called into action. And so I wonder if that isn't maybe what Jesus is after in this crazy parable. It wasn't about financial gain. No, it was about the risks that we take for growth. The risks that we can take when our trust is in the Lord. Not in ourselves, not in the factors that we can control, but in God who equips us with faith and love and hope to go out into the world and take those risks. Jesus was arrested in the garden. He was put on trial, and it all happened at night. And you might remember that when he faces the leaders that arrested him and are putting him on trial in the dark of night, that he confronts them. And he says, hey, everything you're calling me out on is stuff that I did in the daytime. I did it out in the open. I spoke about these things, and I wasn't hiding anything. But here you are with your fear of this change, of what God might be up to in the world, and you are doing it in the dark, keeping it hidden. They are silencing Jesus. But then, the next day, right? Christ on the cross for all the world to see. And of course, those in power meant it to be an example, right, of what not to do. Don't be like this guy. Don't be like him. This is what happens to people who cause trouble, who speak out, who do things like he does, who talk about love and hope and caring for others. But instead, when that all happened in the daytime, it showed what this power that was in place, that was exercising power over Jesus, it showed it for what it really was. It wasn't power from strength. It was power acting out in fear. So then after the daylight of the cross, Jesus goes into the darkness of the tomb, into the darkness of death. But then what happens? It breaks wide open. It breaks wide open to the light of dawn. The stone is rolled away. Jesus is risen. And entering back out into a world that is not without risk, but calling us to follow him into a world that we can enter with courage and with hope, knowing what Christ has done for us. Knowing what he's done for all of creation. So we hear in other gospels about Jesus being the light of the world. And we hear in Matthew's gospel that we're to let our light so shine before others that they may see our good works and glorify our Father in heaven. We hear that at every baptism. It's part of the baptismal promise. Jesus is the light, and he shares that light with us to go out, see the world for what it is, name it, talk about it, and then say, there is a way to transform this. There's a way for us to be transformed, and then go out and help with the transformation. And so, thank you. Thank you for being partners in taking that risk. To imagine that we live in a world that can be transformed and set free. That is good news, and it's not just ours. It's meant to be shared with the world. Amen.
He is seated.
our spoken prayers and all those held in our hearts, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
God's grace. Amen. Lord Jesus, in this simple meal, you have set the banquet. Sustain us on the journey, strengthen us to care for the least of your beloved children, and give us glad and generous hearts as we meet you on the way. Amen. The Lord bless and keep you, the Lord's face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Beloved of God, go in peace to love and